sites of work. Porton Down, the UK's secret biological and chemical weapons complex. Porton Down had received the AIM strain from Fort Detrick in the 80s.
Look at this. Prohibited. And Porton Down.
David Kelly had been head of microbiology at Porton Down. At the time of his death, Porton Down was the target of a major police investigation. Codenamed Operation Antler, it looked into deaths and injuries to British soldiers caused by secret experiments conducted between 1939 and 1989. Attorney Alan Kerr represented some of the victims.
They were experiments, for example, putting men in gas chambers and subjecting them to sarin nerve gas, a chemical warfare weapon, to mustard gas, to Lewisite, to CS gas, which is used for riot control, and also including other substances, for example, the biological agent pyrexial.
After a three-year investigation, the police had enough evidence to recommend the prosecution of eight cases against Porton Down scientists. But just days before Kelly's death in July 2003, the Crown Prosecutor dropped the case.
The Operation Antler investigation wasn't referred to in the Hutton report. And yet, so you basically have 30 detectives who are investigating the goings-on at Porton Down in terms of criminal behaviour. You have Kelly's death, and the two are never put together. It seems very odd. It seems like something dropping behind the filing cabinet. But
human experiments at Porton Down are part of the untold story of the international effort to add biological weapons to the arsenal of war.
Well, you had a collaboration which started off between Britain and Canada in 1940. That expanded, gradually bringing the Americans in, and that then became a division of labor. Research work, for instance, tended to happen in Britain. The idea of production would happen in the United States. Field testing of munitions would happen in Canada.
This collaboration required America's military lab, Fort Detrick, to work closely with Porton Down. Fort Detrick scientist Frank Olson was a liaison between the two facilities. On November 28, 1953, Olson fell 13 stories from a New York City hotel room. Was his death part of a pattern of mysterious deaths of bioweapon scientists, including that of anthrax letter suspect Bruce Ivins, also of Fort Detrick? Did all three scientists know too much? If there is a common thread that ties together a series of untimely deaths of military microbiologists, it may begin with Fort Detrick scientist Frank Olson. His son Eric is convinced his father's plunge from a hotel window was neither accident nor suicide.
He had knowledge about experiments on human subjects. He had knowledge about, you know, extreme interrogation methods leading to death of the subjects. If there was a scary point during the Cold War, that was it.
Frank Olson was an anthrax delivery systems expert, working for the CIA's Special Operations, a covert division at Fort Detrick. His son says Frank Olson wanted out.
What's striking to me is you were bound to get situations during the Cold War where certain scientists, certain policymakers, certain administrators, certain military people knew what was going on and said, you know, we're not doing this. This is not what the United States should be doing. And the question is, what were you going to do with such people? You couldn't put them on trial. You couldn't even put them on military trial. Because in many cases, the stuff they were doing had such a level of secrecy attached to it that you couldn't even deny it. So when a guy like that says he's had enough and he's quitting.
It was not until 1975, 22 years after Olson's death, that the government said he had been given LSD and then jumped out of the window. His son never believed it. In 1994, Eric Olson had his father's body exhumed. one of America's leading forensic pathologists, studied the x-rays and determined Frank Olson had suffered a blow to the forehead before falling to his death.
But you really have to start by seeing not what went on in that little bloody hotel room, but the broader historical picture.
Frank Olson and Bruce Ivins, both Fort Detrick scientists, both dead in controversial circumstances, 50 years apart. David Kelly at Porton Down, another questionable death. All three scientists working with anthrax in state biological research programs. Programs justified in large part by the fact the Russians had been weaponizing deadly germs. Fear of a nightmare scenario in which smaller nations might also develop bioweapons had led the U.S. to initiate the treaty outlawing offensive programs.
The 1972 Biological Weapons Convention, probably the strongest disarmament treaty in human history, right? Because it outlawed not only the use of the weapons, it outlawed the stockpiling of it, outlawed the development of them, and it was really an excellent treaty. And I know most of us thought, whew, thank goodness, there is one threat to human health and welfare that's been put back into the box.
In fact, the Soviet program was never put back into the box. Ken Alabek oversaw a vast secret bioweapons program.
I got an order from the Soviet government to develop industrial process for anthrax industrial manufacturing and a new type biological weapon.
In 1989, as the Cold War was ending, a top Soviet bioweapons scientist who worked with Alabek defected to the West. Vladimir Pasechnik was debriefed by David Kelly on behalf of British intelligence.
That debriefing is extremely interesting because for the very first time, Britain and America became aware of what the Soviet Union had been doing about biological warfare.
Deep inside Russia, bordering Siberia, Yekaterinburg was once a key center of the Soviet Union's bioweapons program. The legacy of this illicit program hangs over the city today. In 1979, one single gram of anthrax escaped Compound 19, a secret army germ warfare lab. The spores carried over the sleeping city by the wind infected thousands and killed at least 66 people. Dr. Lev Grinberg was a state pathologist at the time of the accident.
At first, we thought that it was the plague and not anthrax, because anthrax and the plague are very similar.
The majority of the people in this building died. All of us that worked in the factory, each day we expected to hear that someone else had died. Many died. How can I remember them now?
In the local cemetery, Combs searched for the unmarked section where the victims of the anthrax outbreak were buried in specially made lead-lined coffins. The Soviets never admitted that the anthrax came from a military lab. However, Dr. Grinberg and his colleagues were able to determine the victims had been killed by pulmonary anthrax. The spores had been weaponized, so they were tiny enough to be inhaled, just like the anthrax spores in the U.S. attacks.
In a country that was called the USSR, ensuring this sort of secrecy wasn't that difficult.
Those secrets would prove invaluable for the defector Vladimir Pasechnik. After sharing his knowledge about weaponizing germs with David Kelly and other debriefers, Pasechnik